Heavenly Father, we thank you so much that we have a church that we can come to, Lord, that we can come here, Lord, we can lay our praises and our joys and our sorrows, Lord, at your feet. And we just thank you for Pastor Mike, Lord, for being our shepherd. And we just ask that you will give him the words, Lord. We know that you will just funnel, use the Holy Spirit, Lord, to just funnel everything through him that we need to hear, Father. And your strength is perfect, Lord, and we thank you for that. And we pray all this in your precious name. Amen.
Well, good morning. Every Sunday seems to have its own unique feel to it. This one is no different, everything from Sunday school just to the sharing and appreciative of Paul. Am I really loud?
Yeah, always.
Let's close in prayer. I can hear it. So. This Sunday is no different. I was appreciative to Paul for having all of us pray out loud with each other and share those concerns. It's nice for us to hear each other pray for one another. So, yeah. See, I like to be loud naturally, so this is good. Thank you. Bring it down and I can get all obnoxious. Mark 13, verse 1 reads, "And as he came out of," speaking of Jesus, "and as he came out of the temple, one of his disciples said to him, 'Look, teacher, what wonderful stones and what wonderful buildings.' And Jesus said to him, 'Do you see these great buildings? There will not be here left one stone upon another that will not be thrown down.'" Verse 3, "And as he sat on the Mount of Olives opposite the temple, Peter and James and John and Andrew asked him privately, 'Tell us, when will these things be? And what will be the sign when all these things are about to be accomplished?' And Jesus began to say to them, 'See that no one leads you astray. See that no one leads you astray. Many will come in my name, saying, I am he, and they will lead many astray. And when you hear of wars and rumors of wars, do not be alarmed. This must take place, but the end is not yet. For nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There will be earthquakes in various places. There will be famines. These will be but the beginning of the birth pains." Verse 9, "But be on your guard, for they will deliver you over to councils, and you will be beaten in synagogues, and you will stand before governors and kings for my sake to bear witness before them. And the gospel must first be proclaimed to all nations. And when they bring you to trial and deliver you over, do not be anxious beforehand what you are to say, but say whatever is given you in that hour. For it is not you who speak, but the Holy Spirit. And brother will deliver brother over to death, and the father his child, and children will rise against parents and have them put to death. And you will be hated by all for my name's sake. But the one who endures to the end will be saved." The Bible has a lot to say about suffering. And even though the book of Philippians is a remarkably rejoicing book, it has not turned a blind eye to the fact that we will suffer, even when things are going well. And in this scene in Mark 13, Jesus has a relatively small audience. He's got four disciples here with him, and Peter, James, John, and Andrew. In response to him foretelling the temple's destruction, he gave those warnings. Inherent within those warnings is a teaching about suffering as well, and really suffering well. As turmoil affects creation and nations, and as families turn in on each other, Jesus says to be on your guard. You're going to be turned in, beaten, and hated. In the surprising turn of simplicity, Jesus says, "Do not be anxious. It's not you who speaks, but the Holy Spirit. Be on guard and do not be anxious." As Jesus was preparing his disciples for their future suffering, and in reality, all of his true disciples for theirs, he says to be on guard and do not be anxious. And here's Jesus saying these things weeks, maybe even days before his own torturous suffering, his own mockery of justice. Here he is preparing his followers for suffering. With his cross looming large on the horizon, he prepared his followers for their own. And it is little different here in Philippians. Now, as you turn to Philippians 1, we have one of Jesus' apostles now preparing fellow Christ followers for any suffering that they must face. Paul here is imprisoned, expecting release, but prepared for the gain of death, now moves from autobiographical details to really teachings and exhortations to the church in Philippi to be prepared for suffering. He says, for the sake of the gospel, be prepared for suffering. Suffer well and to suffer together as a church and to see all of it, peace and persecution, as being granted. Granted by the very profession of Jesus Christ as your soul, S-O-L-E, Savior and Lord. Let's hear our text for this morning from Sharon Robinson as she reads from Philippians 1, verses 27 to 30.
I'm reading from Philippians chapter 1, verse 27 through verse 30. Only let your manner of life be worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come and see you or am absent, I may hear that you are standing firm in one spirit, with one mind, striving side by side for the faith of the gospel, and not frightened in anything by your opponents. This is a clear sign to them of their destruction, but of your salvation, and that from God. For it has been granted to you that for the sake of Christ you should not only believe in him, but also suffer for his sake, engaging in the same conflict that you saw I had, and now hear that I still have.
That is the word of the Lord. Gracious God, Father, we admit that suffering often catches us blindsided. But Father, as we work through your word, we see that you have prepared us for suffering. Father, you've prepared us for suffering of many kinds, whether it's suffering just as the consequence, not just, but as the consequence of sin. But Father, you also prepared us for the consequence of suffering as a result of being faithful to you and to your word. God, you are a God that we can trust in. So we take these warnings to heart. Lord, as it becomes increasingly odd for a Christian to stand for your word, Lord, we know suffering will come. But God, you've also promised that we need to be on guard and we need to be not anxious. We can trust in the indwelling power of the Holy Spirit to work in us and through us, to comfort, to heal, to persevere, to preserve, all the while heralding the gracious, loving and merciful gospel of Jesus Christ. And it's in his name we pray. Amen. So to remind us of the context of the passage that Sharon just read for us, Paul has just finished explaining his own suffering in brief detail. Remember from verses 12 through 18, where he basically says, well, what has happened? And then he goes on to explain what has happened, but in very brief detail. He's imprisoned. He's facing persecution from outside of the church. Very reason why he's in prison, and he's also facing suffering and some attacks from inside the church as people are preaching the true gospel, but doing so out of the motive of envy. Like, I want a little bit of what Paul's getting. I want to step into that spotlight, which isn't reality the spotlight of Christ. Paul would never say that it's the spotlight of Paul. He's not creating a church of Paul. He's creating a church of Christ. He is allowing God to create the church of Christ through him. So you even have people attacking Paul, but preaching the gospel, trying to do so out of envy and rivalry against Paul. So he's facing suffering, which is just a remarkable thing for us to hear, because here he is preparing a church for suffering while in the midst of the throes of his own. He's just actually walked through, in verses, the last part of 18 through 26, talking about how he's handling his own suffering, whether he's going to live or die. And in all of it, he wants to honor God, whether living or dying, whether in life or in death. He wants to honor Christ in his body. That is an excellent mindset for us. And he goes so far as to say, whether I live or die, so whether if I live, it's Christ, and if I die, it's gain. So he's preparing this church for suffering autobiographically, and then in verse 27, he actually starts to talk directly to the church. So he's saying, this is how I'm doing it, 19 through 26. This is how I'm preparing it. I want to honor Christ in my body, whether in life or in death. Death is still an enemy. He doesn't long for death because death is so great, but he also knows death brings with it the glorious face of Jesus Christ. He also says, whether I live or die, I want to honor Christ. I want to honor him in my body. And then he moves forward and to say, with that as his backdrop, with that as his preparatory remarks, now church, prepare to suffer. And things are going well in Philippi. They don't have the major issues that we read of in Corinth. So it's almost as if, when things are going well, we need to be reminded and prepare ourselves for suffering. Because if anything's going to change, that's probably what's going to come. Prepare ourselves for suffering. We don't have a God who's removed from suffering. I love that he uses his own suffering as a way to prepare this church, who in all reality, when we compare it to the other letters, is doing quite well. So he models really what Christ did in Mark 13. He models encouraging a church to suffer well in the midst of his own. It's as if he is setting the nail in the wood in those first verses we discussed a couple weeks ago. I've suffered. This is how I've suffered. This is how I'm facing it. And then drives it home. Now this is how you guys can suffer. And suffer well because it's actually been granted to you by God. Which is a concept foreign to us. So he's driving this point home. I want to begin, and I know it's contradictory to good counting, but I do want to begin in verses 29 and 30 as we kind of dive into this text here. Verse 29 reads, "For it has been granted to you that for the sake of Christ you should not only believe in him." We think about our faith, not only believe in him. It's been granted to you to not only believe in him, but also suffer for his sake. We have a penchant in our faith to kind of not want to read these verses. Got to read the whole Bible. It's been granted to you to suffer for his sake. Verse 30, Paul says, engaged in the same conflict that you saw I had, and now here I still have. One commentator I read this past week said, God graciously gives you the privilege of both believing in Christ and suffering in his stead. And like Jesus, when answering Peter, Andrew, James, and John, Paul is addressing the church here. He isn't addressing Timothy or Titus. He isn't saying, Timothy, suffer well. He's saying, church, suffer well. Because it's been granted you to suffer well for the sake of Christ. So the fame of his name goes forward. So that we suffer well, and that becomes part of our witness and our testimony to a world that's suffering. World is hurting. We can model hurting and suffering well as part of the attraction of Christ, because he gives us the privilege of suffering well, because he's given us the Holy Spirit. He sent us the Holy Spirit when he died on the cross to help us suffer well. If the world is suffering and hurting, and we're suffering and hurting well, we should suffer well so that we can be that testimony to Christ, so that we can be that hospital to the hurting, because we have the amazing good news of Jesus Christ to offer. Don't forget the end of verse 1. As we think about who Paul is talking, he's saying to all the saints in Christ Jesus who are at Philippi, everyone in that church is a hearer of this warning, including the overseers and deacons. There's no special bubble of protection for the board. The board will suffer. Pastor suffers. The elders suffer. The deacons suffer. The church suffers. But it is for the sake of Christ that we have been granted to suffer for his name's sake. The more clearly we live and speak and articulate and support and show and testify and witness and example the gospel in our lives, the more likely it is that we will suffer. The gospel doesn't come with camouflage for culture. We don't put on our ghillie suit and walk around and no one sees us. We're just Christians kind of walking around. No, the gospel comes with, you are going to suffer. The more you stand for Christ, the more it's obvious you stand for Christ, we will stand opposite of the tide and the flow of this world, and we will suffer. And suffer well, Paul says, and Christ himself said. The Bible has a lot to say about Christians and the world if you weren't aware of this. I'm sure most of us are. But let's hear from God's word. John 15:19, if you were of the world would love its own. But because you're not of this world, I chose you out of the world. Because of this, the world hates you. John 17:14-16, I've given them your word, and Jesus talking to the Father, I've given them your word, and the world has hated them because they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. I do not ask you to take them out of the world, but I ask you to keep them from the evil one. They're not of the world, even as I am not of the world. 1 John 2:15, do not love the world nor the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. 1 Corinthians 5:9-10, I wrote you in my letter not to associate with the sexually immoral people. I did not mean at all with the sexually immoral people of the world, or with the covetous and swindlers or the idolaters, for then you'd have to be out of this world. Mark what goes on in the church. Keep us distinct from the world. Romans 12:2, and do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, so that you may prove what the will of God is, that which is good, acceptable, and perfect. And James 1:27, pure and undefiled religion is the sight of our God and Father. In the sight of our God and Father is this, to visit orphans and widows in their distress, and to keep oneself unstained by the world. We are in the world, but we're not of the world, Jesus said in his prayer in John 17. We're not to love the things of the world, but at the same time, we're not to bunker up and create a Christian compound. History tells us how that goes, not well. We don't have Christian camouflage in culture. And because of that, we know that then Jesus knows we will suffer. So he says, suffer well. We're not to be conformed to this world, but transformed by the renewal of our minds in discerning God's will. We're to be unstained by the world, but not of it. Over and over and over again, the Bible places Christians in the world, and since if we are truly following Christ, we will not blend in. Our morality will be different. We'll become targets for suffering. And it's here. It's right now, friends. It's in various forms, but it's here and it's right now. This God's word is never out of step with reality. Always timeless. When our faith calls on us to protect life in all of its stages and to value human beings as image bearers of God, you will be called many names. You may lose family, friends, or even jobs. Being biblically pro-life will cost you. When our faith calls on us to stand against the tide of an unrestrained sexual ethic in the millions of ways that that's going in our world today, you will suffer. You may even have fractured relationships with family and even friends. But Paul says it's been granted to you that you will suffer for Christ because it gives you an opportunity to be a testimony for Christ. And Christ tells us that families will endure suffering and that it may result in really broad hatred. His ways are not the ways of the world. And the more committed you are to his ways, the more you stand out in this world. At Sunday school, we had a wonderful time this morning talking about this very topic. And this morning, I look around and I see younger kids who, as some of our older saints said, I'm kind of glad I'm old. So we pray for our Abbeys and our Micahs and our Lincolns and our Brocks and our Katrinas. We pray for you all because you're going to be in this a lot longer. And we fear, no, I'm just kidding. We want you to be strong in the faith and to stand strong for God because you will be called to suffer the more you stand for him. But if you're standing for him and for his sake, it'll be worth it. Not as the world counts worth, but it'll be worth it. So as Paul moved from his autobiographical suffering to talking to these exhortations to the church, and as he closed it out by saying, it's been granted for you to suffer. That's why I said I'm doing it a little bit backwards this morning. I often hate to do that because I know Paul set this argument up under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit in such a way. But I think for our context, it helps us to start with seeing that suffering is granted. To not see that all suffering is us as victims, but that God has granted for you to be able to suffer. And then he moves then. And first he moved to how to suffer well. And I wanted to start with the fact that it is God allowing us to suffer and granting it to us. So he moves from the autobiographical exhortations to the body of Christ in verse 27 when he says, only let your manner of life be worthy of the gospel of Christ. There goes your camouflage. There goes your ghillie suit and your duck hunting hat, or the most strangest camouflage of all, inside your car and your car seat covers. Like the rest of the car they can't see. All of it's gone. We will stand out in this world if you live in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ. So what does it mean to live worthy of the gospel? First, we must see the gospel as a summons. It's a call. It's an exhortation. It's good news. So it's to go forth. It's to be spoken, to be preached, to be shared, to be lived, and to be shown. So it's a summons. It's a call that, hey, world, you are like the rest of us Christians. You're sinners in need of a Savior. Of course, that we tailor the message to our audience. But broadly speaking, it's you're a sinner. You need a Savior. And Jesus Christ is that Savior. Jesus Christ took on your sin debt by becoming man, 100% man, 100% God, another one of those mysteries in Christianity that is tough to wrap our minds around because 100 plus 100 still equals 100. Don't answer that on your math test, and going back to our kids. 100% man, 100% God in one person. And he lived that perfect life underneath the law, fulfilling all of it and God's commands for righteousness. Something you and I stopped doing probably, I don't know when the impetus of sin begins, but David seems to tell us it begins in the womb. He lived that perfect life, knowing that he would suffer and preparing his disciples for their suffering while preparing for his own suffering because he was going to die in the hands of a mockery of justice. His trials were anything but fair. All of culture, military, government, religion, popularity, all of it turned against him. That all paled in comparison to the fact that he was going to bear the wrath of God on your behalf. God poured out the wrath reserved for you because the wages of sin is death, and poured it out on Jesus Christ so that anyone who puts their trust in him repents of their sinful life. It's repentance being a big word of, I recognize God, I'm agreeing with you that I'm a sinner and I need a Savior, and I'm turning from my sin and I'm turning to you. And that first repentance in reality is the beginning of many as we walk in trying to grow in holiness and being more like Christ. And when you repent of your sins, you place your eternal trust in Jesus Christ and in him alone, and it's an exclusive faith in him and in him alone. The only way to the Father is through him. That he welcomes you into his kingdom, that he applies Jesus' death on your behalf to your account, which is excellent news. And it gets better because not only does he take away your sin debt, he grants you Jesus' perfect obedience, his perfect righteousness, so that when God sees you, he sees Jesus. And then it's like the best infomercial ever. But wait, there's more! He sends you the Holy Spirit, God of very God, to live inside of you, to work with your conscience, to carve away at the stones of your heart, because we are going to be sinners. That's not supposed to be what we're known for, but we still sin, so we're going to walk and we're going to fight and we're going to go to war with every single sin, the little to the big, all of them. From gluttony to gossip to the big ones, we're going to fight and we're going to war with God on our side. He's not fighting with you when you sin. He's not fighting against you. He's fighting in step with you. The prepositions got all screwed up there. When you're fighting sin, you're not fighting God, is what I'm trying to say. God's fighting with you on your behalf to help you war against sin. And that's why it's good news. Because there's bad news. And that Jesus came and did that. So the gospel is a summons, and the gospel is a way of life. Live your life in a manner worthy of the gospel. Anyone getting nervous now? Live your life in a manner worthy of the gospel. God knows you're not going to do that perfectly, because it's been granted for you to suffer. So this isn't perfectionism we're talking about. Do we strive for being more like Christ? Absolutely. But don't let every time you sin, you to think that I can't possibly be saved because I'm too dirty. I've done that again. God has to be fed up with that. Yeah, he probably is. But he's going to war with you and fight with you so that you can fight against that sin. You can strive for holiness. Our youth today are told, just give in to that. Society says that's okay. Name whatever that is. God says, no, keep continuing warring and fighting and suffering because it's been granted for you to suffer. Strive for holiness. Strive to be more like Jesus Christ. So live your life, Paul says in verse 27, only let your manner of life be worthy of the gospel. A summons and a way of life. Way behind in my notes, and that's okay. We'll just go right ahead. Bear with me while I catch up with myself. So verse 27, only let your manner of life be worthy of the gospel of Jesus Christ, so that, Paul says, whether I come and see you or am absent, I may hear that you are, so he's already talked about his, I'm pretty sure I'm going to be free, but if I don't, I get to see Jesus, and that's gain. So if I live or die, and if I live, I want to come see you. So he's saying, if I come and see you, I want to see, or and if I don't come see you, I hear that you are standing firm in one spirit. I love this, actually these next three phrases that Paul uses here. He uses this phrase to stand firm, and it actually is a unique term in the Bible. It actually is one that, if we were to translate it woodenly, it means to live all of life in obedience to a city or state. It has a civil component to it. So this word that we have here, which says stand firm, or I'm sorry, I hear that you're standing firm in one spirit. Yeah, standing firm is that striving for living underneath a city-state. So it's really being a good citizen. So there's a civil component to that word. And for an audience that was likely predominantly not Jewish and very Roman and proud of it, it means to live as good citizens of an earthly state, fully discharging one's duties and responsibilities to this state, understanding that your primary citizenship is that of heaven. Be a good citizen, but understanding that you are an ambassador in reality to the citizenship of heaven. So the initial Roman here would have been naturally on board with the first word here, live as a good citizen. But he's going to break it down, and actually already has, because we are living a life worthy of the gospel, that our primary citizenship is that of the kingdom of heaven. And in that, Paul says, be a good citizen. For a Christian, that means be a partner in spiritual fellowship with one another, as we went through that series. Promote righteousness, Romans 13. Seek peace, grow in faith, hope, and love, and aspire to good deeds, and serve one another among many other things. So Paul, in preparing them for suffering to be granted to them for living for and by Christ, strikes a societal note in their ears. Live the gospel. Live as good citizens of the gospel. And why? Because the world is watching. John MacArthur notes, when the unsaved look at the church and do not see holiness, purity, and virtue, there appears to be no reason to believe the gospel it proclaims. When pastors commit gross sins and are later restored to positions of leadership in the church, the above reproach, so we shouldn't be doing that. When church members lie, steal, cheat, gossip, and quarrel, and when congregations seem to care little about such sin and hypocrisy in their midst, the world is understandably repulsed by their claims to love and serve God. And the name of Christ is sullied and dishonored. Close quote. And all too often what Pastor MacArthur just said occurs in the church. So have a good witness. Live the gospel. Verse 27 continues, so that whether I see you or am absent, I may hear that you're standing firm in one spirit. So I did get them mixed up. Paul is encouraging the church to remain in harmony with one another. Since we're citizens of a heavenly kingdom, we need to be of one spirit and stand firm, which is a military term. So he strikes a civil societal note. Now he strikes a military note. And it's a term that means to defend one's position at all costs, up to and leading possibly to your life. Again, keep in mind the audience here. This is very likely descendants of Roman military retired veterans. That's how Philippi was founded. Paul knows his audience and speaks in a way that captures their attention. Be citizens. We're Romans. We got that down. No, be citizens of heaven. Strive like military. Fight. Defend your position. We're Roman. We're descendants of veterans. We got that down. No, worthy of the gospel. Paul knows his audience and captures their attention. And we too need to be focused on the gospel. We need to distill all of life through the good news and see things through the lens of Jesus Christ. This has been Jesus' prayer that we would be one as he and his Father are one. Oh, that we could embody this call and that everything we do and endeavor to do here at Dalton Community Church follows this as well and in our lives. Paul tells them to live lives as citizens of heaven, worthy of the gospel, be united in one spirit as we're standing firm with military-like resolve towards unity. And this isn't overly tolerant speech. Be single-minded. Paul isn't saying kowtow to every whim of culture. As society blows, so blows the church. No, we are to stand firm in one spirit. And remember, Paul is telling this to people who are and who will be suffering. Verse 27 closes with one mind striving side by side for the faith of the gospel. We had a civil societal term, we've had a military term, and here he uses an athletic term. Like teammates, we're to strive together, to contend together, side by side, struggling to support each other and remain unified toward a common goal. And that goal, Paul says, is for the faith. Faith in the grace of God expressed in the finished work of Jesus Christ. Sunday morning rolls around. Well, it's time to go to church, to glad hand some weekend friends, to sing some good songs, and to hear a self-help message. That sound anything like what Paul just described here? Church, strive together, contend together, support one another, love each other in the hard times because you're going to be granted the ability and the privilege to suffer. Let's sing some songs. No, we come here to worship the God who created everything and the God who decided to send Jesus Christ, God of very God, his only Son, to live and to die a torturous, painful death and also to absorb the eternal wrath of God the Father for you. Let's get together and glad hand each other and sing some songs. Sunday morning. Let's tolerate church coffee, but hey, we can check the box. No, we are together in this. We strive together. We have community with each other. We're teammates together. We're embattled together. We're contending for the good of the gospel of Jesus Christ together. May that be our mindset next Sunday morning as we're preparing for church. We're preparing to go strengthen and encourage each other who have just come out of a week of the world. Love each other and contend. That's why we share our struggles with each other so that we can lift each other up, so that we can prop up a shoulder on someone else and say, I got you for a little bit. We can strengthen each other. We can hear from God's word. And as we do that, we know suffering will come. It's been granted to us for the sake of Christ. And when that suffering comes, verse 28 tells us something remarkable, something profound. Do not be frightened in anything by your opponents. Does he say do not be frightened by the easy stuff? What's that? You got to handle that. Our stuff would be terrible. Just do not be frightened by anything in your opponents. Civil, societal, military, athletic. We're striving together. There's an object of world and church here going on. Not that we're butting heads, but that we're trying to be an impact and an influence on the world. Do not be frightened by anything by your opponents. And this is where I'm going to try to distill an argument. I want to make it as simple as possible. There's two absolutely right and okay ways to interpret the rest of this verse. And just about every single English Bible will say this. So do not be frightened. Follow along if you've got your Bibles open. Verse 28. Do not be frightened by anything by your opponents. And then it says, this is, my English Bible reads, this is a clear sign to them of their destruction, but of your salvation and that from God. That's absolutely, that's a fine way to interpret that verse. We can look at and see our suffering as a sign of the fact that God has chosen us to be worthy of suffering. It's been granted to us. And that could be a sign of the other person's or the other viewpoint's destruction. If they don't turn and from their sins and repent and place their eternal trust in God, that's okay. But all English Bibles, just about all of them, add the words "of their destruction." I had a couple hour back and forth with a good friend. Actually, he preached here about 3 years ago. He's getting his doctorate, so I was glad it was on email so that way I could actually understand what he was saying. He's so smart. Yeah, it's like, and I don't think he had a single resource open when he was writing back to me, and it was just amazing. So he kind of boiled it down. He says that this word, this end of the verse 28 can be woodenly translated to say something to the effect of, "and not frightened by anything by your opponents, this is a sign or evidence to them of destruction." We've added the word "there." I actually, not that I think that the way almost all of our English Bibles has it is wrong. I don't think that it's wrong. I think that's an okay way to do that. But I really think that, another way we could see this is that our destruction, they look at our suffering as a sign of our destruction. Paul's saying that's the way they're going to view it. That's a sure sign to them that you're going to be destroyed, that God's not on your side. God must be upset with you. If there is a God, he must be upset with you because you're suffering. If there was a God and you were on his side, wouldn't he just make everything milk and honey? Let's ignore the entire Old Testament for a moment. So he's saying that to them, that's a sign of your destruction. But in reality, because it's a contrasted verb or a contrasted word here, but of your salvation. The sign of your suffering is actually a sign that you're going to be saved, that you are saved, and that your ultimate salvation is coming. And that actually helps me even distill more modern events. I mean, when we think about, it's about 22 Coptic Christians were beheaded in Libya. And I guarantee you the Islamic terrorists were standing there going, "and you think God's on your side? Look, we're going to lob your heads off because you're Christians. That's a sign of your destruction." Paul's saying, they think it's a sign of their destruction. God's saying, "I've granted for you the right and the ability to suffer and to suffer well." And I hope that as those Christians didn't deny their faith, hey, you just turn from Christ and I'll keep your head on your body. That's a tempting offer. But God, where Paul read the pre-sermon verse, will give you the words to say when the moment of your suffering comes, because it'll be the Holy Spirit that works through you. "I don't know if I could stand firm if my life was put on the line for my faith. Am I going to deny Christ or am I going to live?" He says, "No, the Holy Spirit will. Don't worry about what you're going to say." That's why in Mark 13 he can say, "Don't fear, be on guard, do not be anxious." Because the God who created all of this can give you words and give you the resolve to stand for him, because that'll be a sure sign of your salvation. And I pray to God there's an Islamic militant terrorist who saw that and said, "Man, they suffered well. There's something to that Jesus. It's got to be more than the prophet. He is God of very God. I'm going to fall on my knees before him and confess him and repent of my sins. And I'm going to turn from my evil, adulterous, idolatrous ways and turn from the God of the false God of the Quran. I'm going to turn to the true God of the gospel of Jesus Christ." And then when that man dies and stands before God, you know what he's going to say? "Shame on you for killing those guys." No, he's going to say, "Well done, good and faithful servant." Because the blood that he spilled on Calvary can cover a multitude of sins. And we dare not look at that and say, "That's way worse than everything I've done. Oh, I've had idolatry of disgusting order in my life prior to coming to Christ, where I was the king of the world and I was the one that whose happiness and whose life should be risen above all else, and my happiness was the source of what the world should be pointing towards. I was a gross idolater, and God still saved me." That's where I think 28 can make sense, if we see that, oh, your destruction, that's a sign that you're not saved. No, it's a sign of your salvation, and if you suffer well, that's a testimony to Christ. And I think that helps us read 29 even more accurately. "For it has been granted to you for the sake of Christ, you should not only believe in him, but suffer for his sake." So yes, you and I may never face a beating for believing in the gospel of Jesus Christ, or God forbid, for beheading. It's not off the table. But we will suffer for his name's sake. We have not been granted cultural camouflage. We will have conflict in relationships, we'll have conflict in family, conflict in employment, conflict in friendships, because we stand for what Christ stands for. But in the church, we should be striving together in one mind and in one spirit, side by side, striving with one another so that we're strengthened for the trials that will come. And that sort of unity is what God and what Paul and what Jesus Christ were all pointing towards. May that be the life that we have here at Dalton Community Church and beyond, not just for Sunday morning. Sunday morning so that we can Monday through Saturday and do that well. For your glory? No. The glory of God and the glory of God alone. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, there may be people here this morning that are blindsided by the fact that you've granted it for us to suffer from time to time. God, may we be comforted by the fact that you tell us to be on guard, to not be anxious, to not fear, because that indwelling power of the Holy Spirit is with us. The Spirit that testifies to Christ, the Spirit that convicts of sin and righteousness, that as we go along with and walk this road of life, all the while looking to find your will, Lord, as we see it expressed in your word, may we strive for unity in the church, unity towards facing suffering, suffering that will come, and suffering well for the sake of Christ and his glorious name. May that unity in community that we have, Lord, be a testimony to the greater watching world, that yeah, Christians will suffer, but we have each other, but more importantly, Father, we have you. It's in your Son's name we pray. Amen. And that sort of